November 1960. Two political heavyweights are battling it out to be elected to the highest office in the land and be the man who leads his country into the 1960s, a decade which so many are optimistic for. No, I'm not talking about Nixon v. Kennedy. The election I'm talking about happened half a world away in little old New Zealand, where Labour Prime Minister Walter Nash would face Nationals leader Keith Holyoake in a rematch of the 1957 election. The 1960 New Zealand general election took place on November 26, 1960 to elect a total of 80 MPs to the 33rd New Zealand Parliament. Labour had won a slim majority over National in 1957. However, there was a lot of goodwill towards Prime Minister Walter Nash as he and his government began enacting promises they campaigned on, namely increases to social services spending and giving all taxpayers a flat rebate of £100 at the commencement of the pay-as-you-earn income tax. The government was also quick to abolish compulsory military training, something that Labour's staunchest supporters had wanted for a long time. The government would, however, commit to bulking up the armed forces through increased voluntary recruitment, as the country was still engaged in anti-guerrilla conflicts in Malaya, which had been going on since 1948. Nash was also keen to spread New Zealand's influence throughout the Pacific and Southeast Asia. Goodwill towards Nash and the government would not last long, however, as on June 26, 1958, the government would release its first budget. This budget, dubbed the Black Budget, would become infamous in Kiwi history. When Labour took over, they unexpectedly faced a balance of payments crisis, caused by the collapse of the price of butter in Britain. The United Kingdom, you must remember, was still New Zealand's largest export market at the time. Labour MPs were reluctant to cut government spending or break expensive election promises, so Finance Minister Arnold Nordmeyer was left with little option but to raise taxes, which was recommended by both the Treasury and Prime Minister. The budget increased Social Security benefits but was very, very unpopular, not least with Labour's traditional working class supporters. Why, you may ask? Well, the budget raised taxes on cars and petrol, but it didn't stop there as taxes were exponentially increased on beer and tobacco. And if there's one thing the average Kiwi bloke hates more than anything else, it's when teetotaling non-smoking politicians raise the price of his piss and durries. Labour's popularity plummeted overnight, and over the course of the next 3 years it never recovered. Despite efforts to undo the damage done by the Black Budget, like reducing income tax in the 1959 budget, or Nash's attempts to appeal to both middle New Zealand and younger Kiwis by hanging out with American evangelist Billy Graham and Kiwi rock and roller Johnny Devlin. Ironically, not long after the 1958 budget, the price for wool and meat went up and demand for these exports in Britain was still high. So Labour's shot in the foot became a shot in the face as the tax increases turned out to be an overcautious, hasty action by the government. National would seize on this and would see themselves rapidly gain support as opposition leader Keith Holyoake hammered the government on this issue. What's more is that leaked cabinet documents showed that many of Nash's cabinet colleagues were against the increases to beer and tobacco, and that both the Prime Minister and Minister of Finance knew that wool and meat prices were rising. National began using phrases such as the Black Budget and the Panic Budget in their campaigning, which have now become local colloquialism. It was not all doom and gloom for the country, as there were some major wins in terms of social and infrastructure policy. From 1957 to 1960, the percentage of government expenditure on social security benefits rose from 24.2% to 30.4%. The Construction Act 1959 introduced better provisions for the safety and welfare of persons engaged in construction. Free school textbooks for secondary school pupils were introduced. The Government Service Equal Pay Act was passed in 1960 to put an end to separate male and female pay scales in the public service. Construction of new aluminium smelters, hydropower stations and railway lines, as well as the opening of the Auckland Harbour Bridge in 1959, which linked Auckland City with Auckland's North Shore, allowing greater expansion of Auckland. Though, to be fair to the Nats, the money was coughed up under Sid Holland's watch. And with that, the 32nd Parliament was dissolved in October 1960 by Governor-General the Viscount Cobham, and the election was underway. Walter Nash seemed old and out of touch compared to the much younger Holyoake, who had by this time acquired the leadership skills that made him an effective campaigner and more suited for the job of Prime Minister. During the election, both parties developed their own narratives on the history of the balance of payments crisis. Holyoake attempted to contend that Labour had created a panic budget and that overseas funds had not decreased as substantially as Nash claimed in 1957. Furthermore, the fear of import controls in the event that Labour won was the reason for the over-importing. Nash persisted in emphasizing that Labour's action had prevented more catastrophe, and that National had caused the biggest economic crisis since the Great Depression. Interestingly, there was another decline in overseas funds at the start of the election, but neither party commented much about it. The industrialisation agenda dominated Labour's platform, especially in regards to the new Nelson cotton mills. Nash constantly repeated the theme that
people in New Zealand had never been so well off,
and pamphlets stating everyone, everywhere, will again be better off, closely mirroring conservative British Prime Minister Harold Macmillan's winning slogan the previous year, "You've never had it so good." During its campaign, National promised to eliminate mandatory unionism, cut taxes, and loosen import restrictions. And the winner was Keith Holyoake and the National Party by a landslide 12-seat margin. The Nats gained 7 seats to win 46 and 47.6% of the popular vote. Labour would be crushed, losing 7 seats to hold 34 and 43.4% of the vote. A very thorough study of the election by three political scientists concluded that National's preparations for the election, organisation and publicity were much better than Labour's, which was the main reason for the result, with little substantial difference between the parties and policy. National's party organisation recognised their win was mostly due to public mood against Labour and many traditional Labour voters not bothering to vote. Labour's brief return to power only ended in disappointment for the party, and many argue they sealed their fate only a few months after they got back into power. Keith Holyoake would be sworn in as Prime Minister for a second time on December 12, 1960. Despite serving as Prime Minister twice, he's considered the country's 26th Prime Minister, not the 28th. To date, Holyoake is the last New Zealander to have served as Prime Minister twice. The election would also give National 9 brand new MPs. Three of the new National Members of Parliament were called the Young Turks by the press. The Young Turks were Peter Gordon, Duncan McIntyre, and Robert Muldoon, a man you'll hear a great deal more about later on.